To celebrate the harvest each year, people from all over the country and from all walks of life flock to county and state fairs. It's an American way of life, and it's an American tradition.
Welcome to the Alaska State Fair. Hope you're having a good time here today. This is called Blackberry Blossom.
Here in Alaska, it's no different. To celebrate that last fling of summer, Alaskans migrate to 12 regional fairs, the two most popular being the Tanana Valley Fair and the Palmer State Fair. Each year seems to bring more and more Alaskans together. Over 200,000 people came to the Palmer State Fair this year. Officials say that's a record. All these fairs share a common theme, a salute to Alaskan agriculture. For it is during the fair Alaskan farmers proudly show off various examples of their work.
I enjoy the fair very much, and those are the biggest cabbages I've ever seen.
Long days of summer sunshine allow cabbages from the Matanuska Valley to tip the scales at an incredible 70 pounds. Alaskan-grown vegetables are in a class by themselves. They are generally regarded as the largest and best tasting in the nation.
We came up here for the fair on purpose to see the big fruit display and vegetable display. It really is a treat to see something like this.
Industry and government people alike are very optimistic about agriculture and what agriculture can do for Alaska. Bob Palmer from the governor's office.
We have something approaching 17 million acres of good agricultural soils in the state of Alaska. We have the makings of a renewable resource industry that can go a very long ways towards leveling out some of the boom and bust cycles in Alaska. Nothing is more stable, as far as an industry is concerned, than agriculture.
Actually, the various government agencies that are involved with agriculture in the state slightly disagree with Bob Palmer's figures. The agencies report there are over 15 million acres of soil that could someday be used as farmland, not the 17 million that Palmer talks about. Nonetheless, the point is, the potential here is enormous. Alaska ranks in the top 10 nationally for potential cropland.
The potential is there very much. I think that the technology is already here for commercial production of vegetable crops. Markets and some of the other social political aspects of our society are really the things that are holding us up, I think.
But when one looks at the reality of Alaskan farming and not the potential, the picture turns dismal. Over the past 20 years or so, agriculture has been suffering from a serious decline in production. Products like hay, potatoes, eggs, and milk, just to name a few, are all grown and produced in smaller amounts today than in previous years. Alaska farm products in 1978, the latest statistics available, were worth only $9 million. Compared to other states, Alaska ranks on the bottom for crop and livestock value, even less than Rhode Island. And yet both federal and state governments spend a total of $29 million to support the industry. Most of the money comes from the state, which has been criticized for spending too much. A major investment has been the Delta Barley Project. The project has been plagued with rumors of inferior quality grain and poor management, which have added fuel to the criticism. However, the state is trying to move ahead with farming in Alaska. Agricultural research and development comes mainly from the experimental stations.
At the experiment station, we're trying to help the farmer develop and the homeowner develop a better production, both in the crop area and in the animal area.
The experimental farm here in Fairbanks is only one of three. The others are in Palmer and Homer. Studies are conducted to determine what effect Alaskan conditions have on farm plants and animals. Research is done on soil composition, soil temperature, and the effects of long periods of sunshine, just to name a few. The knowledge gained by this research is passed on to farmers for possible implementation.
Take, for example, in broccoli. We've had improved in a number of crops, but in broccoli, we found several hybrid-type varieties like Green Duke that will increase the production five times, maybe. It is a hybrid. The seed is a little more expensive, but all told, it's the way to go in this at this time.
That's a result of the research done here?
Yes, there's variety testing, you bet.
Government-sponsored research not only benefits the commercial farmer, but it also helps the small-scale farmer, who, according to Professor Dinkel, is also an important part of Alaskan farming.
We have some commercial farms that aren't usually reported in the statistical reporting services. The greenhouse industry is an example. I keep telling my director that the greenhouse industry in Alaska is Alaska's largest agricultural industry. And we have many, many greenhouse operations that are on a solid footing. They're good economic units, and they contribute a great deal to the quality of life in Alaska, the commercial greenhouse units.
Experimental farms are not the only example of government involvement in Alaskan agriculture. In 1935, the federal government resettled 204 families in Palmer. They came from Minnesota, Michigan, and Wisconsin. The project became known as the Matanuska Valley Colony. Arnold Carson came to Alaska as a colonist when he was 33 years old. He brought with him his family, including a 10-day-old child.
Well, we took a train to Seattle, and then we took the St. Mihiel to Seward. And hard times out there in the Depression years. So I thought, you can't lose. You come up here, you get a fresh start. They had set up tents. And they were just, we moved into the tents while the people that were putting them up still wasn't all, really have them all set up.
The experiment was a New Deal project. The government offered these farmers new land and new opportunities. They came from economically depressed communities with marginal farmland. The government offered each family 40 acres from as low as $5 an acre. The land was to be used for subsistence as well as commercial farming. The government built for the colonists houses, barns, provided them with groceries, equipment, farm animals, seeds, tools, and all on 3% interest. Each family began paying back their individual loans in 1940. On May 23, 1935, the land tracts were selected.
This is the original 40 acres that I drew out of a hat.
The task of clearing, planting, and building were formidable. All supplies and materials were shipped as far as Seward and then brought to Palmer by train. By the time the federal government was through spending, it had invested nearly $5 million in the project.
It was definitely successful, sure it was. They was going to take so many people out of a drought-ridden place where there was no jobs for them and no hopes there, but it was going to be an experiment, and I think it was very successful. Yeah.
The Matanuska colonists worked very hard trying to make a living at Alaskan farming. A lot has changed since 1935. Even though technologies have improved, Alaskan farming is still backbreaking work. This is Steve Hamilton, a dairy farmer in Palmer. It's 5:30 in the morning, too early for most people, but Hamilton has already been on the job for 2 hours.
You know, you have to like it too. You have to love it, or else you're just wasting your time, because it demands all your time. 7 days a week, 365 days a year, Christmas, Thanksgiving, everything else.
When compared to other forms of Alaskan agriculture, dairy farming is something special. It is the most successful type of farming in the state. But government officials say the survival of the dairy business is questionable. On an individual level, Steve Hamilton says you need only three elements to make a go of it.
We're developing a real good herd of cows. We grow good, real good quality feed, and we have good facilities, and that's really the three things that you... three basics that you need for, I think, to make a success in dairying.
24 years ago, the Hamiltons bought this 275-acre farm. They had one tractor and 23 cows. Now they own 325 cows, of which nearly 200 have to be milked twice a day. This modern facility is worth about $5 million. But unlike other agricultural operations that are seasonal, dairy farming is stable, operating year-round.
Dairy is really the only, here is the only agricultural entity that has an established marketing system, and which that's the biggest thing it's got going for us. For it has plus you market your crop year round. You have that steady paycheck coming in every 2 weeks.
But many fear the dairy business has been seriously threatened. For example, in 1961 there were 2,800 milk producing cows in the state. Today, there are only 1,300. That's a decrease of over 50%. Some dairy farmers have retired. Others have gotten out of the business for economic reasons or because they can make more money doing something else. Declining milk production also threatens related businesses like transportation, processing, and marketing. Unless this trend gets turned around, it will only be a matter of time before the dairy industry completely folds.
Dairy has been the keystone. Once we lose, if we ever lose the dairy, I think it will suffer a real setback in what little agriculture we've got here.
The greatest threat to all types of Alaskan farming is the lack of land. Without a broad land base, agriculture cannot survive. As we pointed out earlier in this broadcast, Alaska has 15 million acres of suitable agricultural soil. This diagram represents those 15 million acres. It is divided into 100 squares. The shaded area in the middle represents 1% of the total. In 1968, crops were harvested from 20,000 acres. That's the green area. Those 20,000 acres are only 0.1% of the total. It is an incredibly minute amount. But if recent trends continue, even this small amount of land will be eroded away for other uses besides agriculture.
We do not have land available at the moment. A lot of the Mat Valley where I grew up is now a bedroom for Anchorage, for example. So there isn't readily available a lot of land.
The Matanuska Valley, by far the most important geographic area in Alaskan farming, has been turned into a checkerboard pattern of development. At one time, this land used to be a hayfield. Now it's a shopping center. It's indicative of the current trend. Land can bring a premium price because so little is available for people to buy. Demand is high, causing the price to skyrocket. Many potential buyers are from Anchorage, seeking to beat the rat race of the big city for the mellow lifestyle of the country. Developers like the land company have bought large chunks of land and turned it into subdivisions. Example, Brentwood Estates. At least a portion of this subdivision was once a hayfield. Now the developer can sell it for at least $10,000 an acre, sometimes even more. They say business is booming.
If the farmers are losing land to subdivisions, the shortage of land has caused the price to be pushed up to where the farmer cannot afford to continue to farm, either psychologically or physically. When you get a dairy farmer that's milking cows on a farm and he all of a sudden finds out his farm is worth $3,000 to $5,000 an acre and his 200-acre farm is worth millions of dollars, he's not going to farm very long. And you're seeing that happen in the valley.
Nick Carney went on to say that eventually all the land in the Matanuska Valley will someday be used for something else besides farming. But land is not the only problem facing the Alaskan farmer. Many times outside products, usually shipped in from Seattle, actually cost the Alaskan consumer less than the Alaska-made product.
You've got to realize that Alaskan farmers have had a very difficult time being competitive over the years. The reason for that is that our industry is so small that it has not been able to support the normal infrastructure requirements. When I talk about infrastructure, I mean the industry components.
Those industry components, like a marketing system, feed for the animals, or specialists who fix farm machinery, are just as important to the farmer as being able to grow his crop. Without these components or infrastructure, farming cannot survive. Unfortunately, Alaska does not have much of an infrastructure. An example of this is the Alaskan egg farmer. Lucerne eggs, produced in Washington and marketed by Safeway, directly compete with Totem Eggs, an Alaskan operation from Palmer.
And our production right now must be right in the neighborhood of 14,000 eggs a day. We have, at the present, about 19,000 chickens.
We have about 600,000, and by the end of the year, we'll be up to about 850,000.
This is a classic example of big being better. 100% of Totem's production is sold within the state. Wilcox, who produces for Lucerne, sells only 10% of its eggs to Alaska. Because of the size of the operation, Wilcox can produce a dozen eggs cheaper than Totem.
To a certain point, there is economies in large numbers.
With Alaska's relatively small population, it would be uneconomical for Totem to buy a 500,000 chickens to compete on the same large scale. There just wouldn't be a large enough market.
Outside eggs come in pretty cheap.
Why is this? Why are Lucerne eggs cheaper than Totem, even when Lucerne have to be transported 1,500 miles to Anchorage? The answer is infrastructure. Wilcox has chicken feed readily available from the railroad that comes within 10 miles of the farm. Wages are about 25% less than Alaska. They have a sophisticated marketing system with a large population ready to buy their eggs. These industry components are not established in Alaska. It's expensive to create them, and that cost is passed on to the consumer.
You've got to remember that all of our costs up here are higher, so thereby offsetting a good portion of that difference between the outside price and the local price.
What does this mean to the Alaskan consumer? Washington State, 79 cents. Alaskan, $1.35. With all the problems and disappointments that have plagued the farming industry in the state, is there really any hope that Alaska will someday realize its full agricultural potential? Well, the state hasn't given up. In fact, they have started one of the largest farming projects ever seen in Alaska. It's called the Delta Agricultural Project.
We started out with grain because it's simple. It's the first crop that a farmer has to plant when he starts to clear fields, and it's something that will support on a gross scale the infrastructure requirements, financing, the equipment dealers, the equipment repairmen, processing, elevators, transportation networks.
With a strong grain base, officials hope to create large-scale meat production using the grain as feed for chickens, pigs, and cattle. Agriculture could bloom to a multi-million dollar industry, creating many jobs for Alaska. This is Alaska's hope. In 1968, the state sold 60,000 acres in the Delta Junction area, some 100 miles south of Fairbanks, to 22 Alaskans. Only agricultural rights were sold, and the landowners are prohibited to use the land for other kinds of development. But this is a new game for Alaska, and problems show up in many areas. Take, for example, the grain elevator in Delta.
The builders here in this country has got a lot to learn about building elevators. This co-op is building these elevators and not understanding, time involved, the time it takes to set up an elevator.
Ever since this project started, it has been shrouded in public skepticism and controversy.
I think it was an administrative mess.
Right from the beginning, the Delta project got off on the wrong foot. State Ombudsman Frank Flavin was called on to investigate the way the state disposed of the farms.
Well, basically, we found that the Delta project was flawed in a number of areas administratively. One area was in publicity, the second was in the selection of the people that got the farm parcels, and the third area was the legal premise.
At the conclusion of Flavin's report, he writes, and we quote, "Somebody forgot the people. Not the collective Alaskan who everyone patronizes, but that individual, that real person out there with real expectations and real needs. In concern over the viability of the project, we forgot about the needs of the individuals." Not everyone agreed with that analysis.
Well, it was completely in error, quite to the contrary of what the original report said. It was the people that were kept in mind constantly. Did everything that we possibly could to make it fair and to give the project and the individuals within the project the best chance of being successful.
The Special Projects Office, I'm sure, was not delighted with our report. I think their first response was that since this office did not consist of agricultural experts, we had no business reviewing the sale. And my basic response, I grew up on a farm myself, which is more experienced than many of the lottery people who were able to participate in a lottery had, and it doesn't take much agricultural experience to recognize BS when you see it.
The problems have continued. A forest fire threatened the project, and buffalo have found barley more tasty than their natural food, which has attracted them into farmers' fields. But nothing has eroded public confidence in the project more than reports that potential foreign buyers had found Delta barley inferior. The report came from the April 25th edition of the Anchorage Times. The Times quoted a Japanese barley specialist saying the barley was inferior. State officials are adamant the story was neither fair or accurate. Alaska Review investigated. We wanted to find out two things. Is the barley inferior, as reported in the Anchorage Times, or is it a high-quality product that state officials have led people to believe? And are foreign countries interested in buying? Our first step was to obtain a barley sample. Then, to ensure an impartial evaluation of the Delta barley, we had the Washington State Grain Inspection Service conduct a test that would tell us the grade of the sample. There are 5 grades of barley, and the minimum standard that is allowed for export is number 2. The best Alaska could hope for is grade number 1. The worst, number 5. Our grain was evaluated under the skillful hands of Inspector Mike Wegener. The sample was sifted, separated, and weighed. Tests were run to determine the amount of foreign matter and the percent of moisture. The barley even had its temperature taken. Each seed was individually scrutinized. What kind of conclusions can you draw from this test that you've just done?
This sample is number 1 barley, tough, with a 15.6% of dockage, or moisture, excuse me.
We left the inspection station and went to Lauk's Testing Laboratories, an independent and highly recommended chemical lab. We asked that a test be done to determine the protein level of our Delta barley. Our sample was ground into a fine powder and mixed with a variety of chemicals. The solution was heated, and the chemicals began to react with one another.
I need to sound myself back to this.
And that makes it 10.8%.
Armed with our scientific data, we made one last stop. We went to Fisher Mills, a Seattle-based feed company, to get a definitive statement about the quality of Alaskan-grown barley.
This would sell on the world market and compete with other barley exported from the United States very easily.
Once it was determined that the barley was not inferior, Alaska Review went to the Japanese consulate to see if they were interested in buying.
If Alaska wish to export to Japan the barley produced in Alaska, it should be a competitive in price and quality, and your state must assure the consistent supply in volumes.
Sending grain overseas is more than just a prospect for Alaska. The barley project is only in its second season, and already an order for 1,000 tons has been placed from Taiwan. There is no question that quality farm products can be grown in Alaska, but whether agriculture can reach its full potential and become an economically viable industry is another question. The festival of fairs that happen around Alaska each year reflect the optimistic hopes many have for the future expansion of Alaskan agriculture. Thank you.